used to sing all the time as children and learn songs. Our mother'd play the piano. My father loves to sing. And he'd get us all singing in the car, and I was sitting behind his chair, and what I remember is he was singing a part that was a lot different than what the others were singing. And it intrigued me, and I started singing his part. Pretty soon I found that I was singing a harmony.
We worked hard as little kids, you know, trying to harmonize and make our blend really something special. And I guess our father knew that brothers, because we all have the same voice basically, can harmonize real well together.
We're side by
side.
My father was a sergeant, Army sergeant. He taught Alan the trumpet, and Alan woke us up to reveille every morning. I'm going, oh, I'm glad when he threw away that trumpet.
In the back of our home, he built a dormitory, and he went and bought 7 Army cots. And you could go across, and it was Verl, Tommy, Alan, Wayne, Merrill, Jay, Donnie.
Like barracks, I guess you'd call it. It was very structured, very, not militaristic, but sort of.
I remember at night we would lay in those Army cots and just sing until we fell asleep. And those were good days.
I'm Alan.
I'm Wayne.
I'm Merrill.
I'm Jay, and I'm 6 years old.
I'm 8.
I'm 10.
I'm 12 years old, and I'm the bass.
I'm the baritone.
I'm the tenor.
I'm the lead.
We'd get up in the mornings, like at 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning, and we would go do our chores, milk the cows, feed the pigs, whatever. Go get dressed, go to school, come back from school, take a nap, and we would drive to Salt Lake City, for instance, and do a show. Come home, drop in bed, and repeat that over and over and over. So, I mean, that might sound crazy to a lot of people, but that was our life.
With the Osmond Brothers Quartet, we love to sing, you bet. So hello to everyone. Hi there!
And that's well done, boys. That's real well done.
I remember my father telling me that he received a phone call. And he said that, he says it was Andy Williams' father. And he said, this is Jay Williams. He said, have you ever heard of Andy Williams? My father said, no.
Ladies and gentlemen.
And he brought him in the studio one day, and he made us stop the rehearsal. And all the dancers and everybody sort of sat around on the floor. And these 4 Osmonds came in and sang for us.
We'd sing a song and they'd laugh. And Jay would do something wrong and they'd laugh. And then we'd do the little routines. They were corny, really corny. And they'd laugh. And then and after we were worried that they laughed at us so much. And my father said, good job.
They were really funny. And my father said, I think you should put them on your show. I said, yes, sir.
Which one are you?
Merrill Osmond.
Which?
Merrill Osmond.
And you?
Wayne.
And what's your name?
Alan.
Jay.
You're the oldest, huh, Jay?
I think so.
Where are you fellas from?
Ogden, Utah.
They even said that in perfect unison, Ogden, Utah.
I guess I'm like most everybody. I saw the Osmonds first on the Andy Williams show. This sweet, young barbershop quartet singing first with no music, beautiful harmony, radiant faces.
Be my little baby bumblebee, buzz around, buzz around, buzz around.
The mayo was so tremendous in the reaction from everybody that we asked him to come back, you know, the next week. And I don't think we ever had a contract with them, but they just kept coming back every week. And they were like sponges. They would do whatever they were told. If we needed somebody to do pogo stick jumping around, they'd learn how to do that, or they'd learn how to do unicycles. And so they were so easy to work with and so malleable that the choreographer loved to work with them because he could teach them how to dance it like that. So if you get 4 trained dancers and you tell them to do a move, there are 4 different moves. Even though they're doing the same step, but they don't look exactly alike. But brothers do, especially if they're untrained. And they were like that. They were just terrific.
They called us the one-take Osmonds. Well, that's a lot of pressure, you know, because everybody else, you know, they'd take two or three times to do it right, and they'd goof up. And but there was a certain level of expectation for our family.
We had that dream and that goal, very goal-oriented family. We were able to say, if this is what we really want, let's not complain about it, let's just get it done. Our parents were extremely good. I mean, always motivating us to get going. They never drove us. We drove ourselves, but they led us.
I don't know if they ever played with a baseball. I don't know if they ever threw a football out in the street, but they certainly threw a lot of notes and music. And there was nothing they couldn't do. Dad used to bring them over to my house that first year. Some of the first arrangements that we learned, the kids could sing them and didn't understand what the words were. I had to explain what the words were to them.
I remember seeing them on the Andy Williams show and thinking, wow, that looks like a lot of fun. I had no idea how much work was involved. That's when it all started. I wanted to be a part of that group, that band, the Osmond Brothers.
You mean you have a brother?
Yes, sir.
Well, where is he? Is he here?
Yes, sir. There he is. Come on.
Oh, my. What is your name? Donnie?
Yes, sir.
Well, how old are you?
5.
Because of the spotlights, I couldn't see anybody. I mean, it was just all black. I thought, you know, the first couple of rows, there's maybe 50 people out there watching me.
Yes, sir, she's the neatest and also the sweetest. Yes, sir, that's my baby now.
I don't mean maybe.
Yes, sir, that's my baby now.
No, you don't.
Finished my song, and thunderous applause. And I thought, what's going on? My brothers were smiling at me, and Andy was applauding. I thought, wow, this is all for me. I said, this is what I've got to do the rest of my life. That's when the bug bit, right there. The machine was rolling. The locomotive had inertia, and there was no stopping it. I mean, we could opt to stop it, but the demand was there for the Osmond Brothers on the Andy Williams show. Parents were writing in who watched Andy Williams and said, oh, I want my kids to be just like you and keep going and all this kind of stuff. And my parents were reading all this and said, wow, we got a career. So it was the synergy of our career that kept us going. And I look back, I don't really know what kept me going. I guess I was just following. You know, I was just following the brothers because there was always a gig to be done.
I like electronics and, or I'll stay in the show business too. And, or else I'll go into hotel management.
I'm gonna play a bellboy and
Aren't you gonna be a singer?
I'm gonna be a minister too. I'm always like Donnie.
As far back as I can remember, I've been performing with my brothers. And I started when I was really 3 years old on the Andy Williams shows. And but I always was kind of like a little soloist, which is kind of weird, you know. And but I always knew my brothers were behind me. I felt safe with them there.
Ladies and gentlemen, Jimmy and his group.
I want some red.
I was 5 years old, and I was in Japan, and there was this promoter that came up, and also a gentleman from Sony, that said, wouldn't it be interesting if your little boy could sing in Japanese? And so I learned how to sing this little song phonetically, and it ended up being a number one record.
I'd like to be a showgirl. Really, I started performing when I was about 7 years old, and we used to go over to Sweden, and I learned to sing Swedish and did my numbers, you know, Vid mycket glada vore här I Sverige, all those things. I can do it all phonetically, I don't know what it means. Was more of a token gesture, you know, the only sister, and folks, she can sing too. And so I was more of a novelty that was used for Christmas shows and things like that.
We were touring Sweden, and I hated it. I didn't want anything to do with it, because I thought, wait a minute, this was supposed to be fun. We were doing three shows a day, every show was in a different city, and we were setting up our own sound and lights. We had a three or four piece band, and it was hard work. And I realized at that point, you know, this isn't all fun and games anymore.
This group called the Beatles. They're really, oh, I like that. And we went down, bought Fender guitars and amplifiers, and we wanted to be like the Beatles. Now we were doing this young music that we really could relate with. And that did a turn, and we realized then, we've got to be who we are.
I've always believed in the theory that if you have fear, then you have no faith. And as I look back at some of the things we did as a family, one of the main decisions that were made early on was to leave the Andy Williams Show. It was a very, very scary moment, but one that was we had to do to progress with our music.
And it got very lonely right after that decision because nothing happened. There was no records. There were no record producers. It all had to come from within now. And there were no gigs out there for us to do. It was, we weren't making any money. We thought, well, maybe we did make a mistake, but we hung on to that belief and that idea, and we met a great man named Mike Curb who believed in us.
You need love, but you're afraid that if you give in, someone else will come along and suck you to your game.
He said, you guys are singing really soulful. You need to maybe get out of Los Angeles and go to Muscle Shoals, Alabama. A great friend, Rick Hall. He says he produces great R&B records, and let's see what we can come up with.
I didn't choose to be the lead singer. I mean, I was sort of picked out as we went through this process. Alan sang and Wayne sang, and I finally got the gig. If you could come up with this sound, you know? So I stayed at that microphone hours and hours and hours at a time. I got tears in my eyes because I couldn't deliver what this man wanted me to. I remember one day I was sitting there and I started to bleed. Blood was coming out of my mouth. I was bleeding from inside.
One bad apple don't spoil a whole bunch, girl.
Sitting at home in Los Angeles. KHJ was the top station at the time. We were listening to the radio on the countdown, and it came up there to number, and now the number one record, the Osmonds, One Bad Apple. We screamed like crazy. We finally made it.
Yeah!
We went to Cleveland and to Columbus, Ohio, and we booked two shows in a 10,000 seat arena. We said, let's see if it'll work. Sold out. We came out with these jumpsuits. We knew Bill Ballou, who made Elvis Presley's costume. We went out there, and the girls screamed like crazy. And I got to tell you, we were scared. We had never seen something like that, never heard that. We rushed the show. We were singing sharp, everything. We were so excited. We came off that stage, and we didn't know what was going on.
I think the reason One Bad Apple took off is that it was kind of like the White Jackson Five. there was really no design from our point of view. Maybe from the marketing people of MGM Records there was.
ABC.
With ABC, and I think just like 3 or 4 months later, I'm not sure, One Bad Apple came out, and it was a soulful white band, you know, that sounded black. And as a matter of fact, to this day, people keep saying, "Now, was that you or the Jacksons?"
The minute they had that hit, we knew that that would launch them, and even though people would be comparing them to the Jackson 5, we thought that was better than comparing them to a barbershop quartet, which is what they had been on the Andy Williams show. Then they started doing their own thing.
Down by the lazy river, come as you please. Down by the lazy river, one big family. Take me in your arms to stay, and I'll never go
ever get into this.
Never mind. Let's just get it over with.
And they called it puppy love. Oh, I guess they'll never know how a young heart really feels and why I love her so.
I remember a time I showed up at the recording studio thinking that we're going to go do some demos, or we're going to work on the Osmond Brothers project. Mike Kerb walked in. And this is pretty much how it all happened back then. He says, "Okay, Donnie, you're going to record this song, you're going to record that song, this is the song you're going to do." I'd show up to the studio and my whole album was laid out. We had, I don't know, 30, 40, 50 piece orchestra in M1, the big studio. I had no idea what was going on. And there's a vocal booth. And I learned the song Puppy Love, and I didn't know that this whole day was set aside for Donny Osmond. And I walked in there, and we did it live.
Kids around the world await Osmonds.
Man, I can't believe it. Around the world, on our own jet plane.
This is your captain speaking. Kindly board the plane.
We're on.
And Germany was great, France was great, Holland, Belgium, all those places in Europe were just wonderful. And I can only look back at it saying, that was amazing. You know, how blessed I was to be part of that. But the UK stands out greater than any of those places.
Little girls of a certain age respond to romance. There's nothing overtly sexual. Donnie was a sort of boy that little girls could fantasize. You could take home to mum, and mum would like him, and granny would like him, and dad would like him. And you could sit and look at his cute little face over the tea table, and you know that he wouldn't show you up, and you'd know that he'd respect you, and he'd be nice, and he wouldn't try and push you too far.
On the plane over to London, I was informed that we're going to have some problems. And I always loved it when they said, "We got problems." I always thought, "Oh, this is great." So there's going to be a lot of people there. I had no idea what they meant by a lot of people. And they said, "We want you to get off the plane last. You know, we'll get everybody off the plane." And the whole plane was like buzzing about this. What's going on? What's going on? Because people were running back and forth talking to us about all these people that are showing up at Heathrow.
We suggested to Tony Prince that he might like to give out the flight number and where they were arriving, because we knew that we would never get that cooperation from the British Airports Authority.
We weren't allowed to do that.
The British Airport Authority went mad and summoned us to a meeting, which I remember vividly, in their offices, when we said, We don't understand how this could have happened. I mean, he wasn't supposed to have done that.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. This is your royal ruler, Tony Prince.
Keep real cool, and in about 25 minutes from now, if the flight comes in on time, the boys will be waving at you all and blowing your kisses, all right?
And they were saying, well, there's nothing for it. You've got to divert the plane to Luton.
We said, you're crazy.
I said, you're crazy. If the record company or the British Airports Authority puts out a statement that the Osmonds plane is being diverted to Luton, no one will believe you. And they will stay at your airport and they will create havoc at your airport because they will be angry.
That's right.
We got off the plane and there were all these Bentleys waiting for us. And I looked at all these people waiting on the observation decks. It was a weird time. Just weird, just all these flashes going off, and it was exciting.
The Osmonds actually didn't know what we did. I don't know if they thought it happened, actually. I honestly don't know. I've never asked them.
Well, they sold records, they were popular, but, you know, exactly, they did what they were told, in a sense.
I mean, it's not meant badly,
but they, you know, they just followed the program, didn't they?
I mean, we, in fact, David and I used to plan everything. We planned everything.
I love you, darling Donny. You're my very life. I dread the day when you will take yourself a wife. My dreams will be shattered, my world fall apart. So please, let me see you, soothe my aching heart.
Well, I always decided if Donny Osmond wasn't going to ask me to marry him, then I'd marry Jay. He was my second best. I always decided, you know.
You've been my favourite since I was 11 years old.
Is that right? What was it about Donny? He was just, he was the cutest. I mean, no beating around the bush. And I think he still is, and he's a good-looking chap still.
The effect that it had on the magazine was extraordinary, because suddenly, every time you printed anything about the Osmonds, and particularly about Donny, but it was also the whole family, the circulation just immediately shot up. And we went from something like about 500,000 to 1 million in over 8 months.
They were always singing to me, and that's what you felt. Although the next day at school, you'd go in and you'd talk about it and you'd say, oh, wasn't it wonderful? And then they did that song, and that was so lovely. So it was something that you could share with your friends. Absolutely, they weren't, I was never sort of selfish about it, but they were talking to me.
Good evening. On Tuesday this week, I think I heard what must have been the loudest noise I've ever heard in my life. Just listen to it for a moment.
I remember one girl that mailed herself to him, and I remember another girl that chopped down the back exit door of the hotel, forced her way up it with an axe. And my father goes, relax, relax, she can see him, she can see him. And so he took her over to the room, knocked on his hotel door, he opened it, and she passed out. I thought, she went to all that effort and then she had to faint?
We had Led Zeppelin sound system and we still couldn't hear us. We went down as one of the loudest bands, not because of the music we were pumping out, because all the audience was screaming this way. And the decibels were so loud that it was just very, very intense. In fact, it caused us to lose a little hearing ourselves. Wayne's lost this side, and I've lost this side, because I was on stage right.
Disguise time, guys. Hey, Fuji, bring us the beer.
Poor little Donnie, he didn't go anywhere at all. But we said, Donnie, look, we just did the big concerts at the TV station. You go up in the window, and when you go up in the window, they'll all scream, and the rest of us will go out the back door and get into a taxi cab that was all arranged.
Let's go.
On cue, Donnie came to the window, and thousands of kids came running over screaming. The rest of us went through the back doors. We crawled on our hands and knees, and we crawled through this Chinese restaurant. People didn't know what the heck was going on. We're crawling through the Chinese restaurant. We finally go out the back door, and there's the cab waiting. We jump in the cab, and we say, go! And the guy says, where? We had the wrong cab.
These beards saved us. Boy, I tell you, this situation could be dangerous.
Yeah, but what great danger.
I was trampled several times. I just wish there was a way we could have avoided a lot of that. It was really dangerous. Yeah, it was more dangerous than people really thought. Because, I mean, you take 150 girls at one time on a car, it doesn't feel good.
They get hysterical. They got no heed of traffic. They will just run straight out into the road, willy-nilly.
We come ripping through part of the town just in time for a couple of little gals to run in front of our car, and we hit them. We said, stop, and they couldn't stop.
I went to the hospital to have x-rays, but that's all.
And there was some compensation for it, wasn't there?
Yeah,
what
a telephone happened? Call and two tickets for the concert.
Telephone call from who?
Donnie.
Sighs again. What did he say? What did he say to you?
Well, I don't really know. I just couldn't hear him. I was crying.
Everybody found out where we were, and I saw this sea of people coming towards me. And all I heard was, run! And I couldn't outrun these fans, and they grabbed me and ripped my, it was my favorite shirt, they ripped my shirt off, and this one girl, she wanted my autograph, and she wanted to hug me, and she didn't know which one to go for first. And so she had her pen in her hand, and she wrapped her arms around me, and the pen went right there, and went all down my face. Didn't cut it open completely, but it almost, I almost lost my eye from that moment.
What state is it that they're in? That
this is a
about?
State of acute hysteria, really, made by stimulating the nervous system, in which the computer, I mean, everybody's listening to me now and is checking up what I'm saying and computing what I'm saying. The computer gets knocked out, and you simply take on the pattern of your surroundings. So that if somebody starts screaming, somebody else starts screaming. And the whole thing becomes infectious. And this chap said, for instance, that that at the end of that program, you know, Bell and I,
the concert, yes.
Half the people have passed water on the floor.
You wouldn't be frightened off by actual hysterical reactions among girls listening to you?
Not as long as people didn't get hurt, then it'd be all right.
Yes.
I think it's good. I think, you know, they can get a lot of things out of them at that kind of concert. I think it's all right.
Movement! Let this little girl get above the floor. Go back to your seats. Go back to your seats. Come on, then the show will continue. Come on, let's everybody sit down. Then everybody can see the show. It's time to calm down.
We turned on the television and onto the BBC. There were these three people, a commentator, a gentleman from the Scotland Yard, and a lady from the Scotland Yard. They were all having this discussion as to whether Donny Osmond should be deported from England, whether I was healthy for the young girls of England, or whether they should get me out of the country. And I thought, oh, wow, this is cool. Here I am just doing my gig, you know, and now I got all these policemen talking about me. I thought, wow, I got to remember this moment. And Alan turned to me. I'll never forget. Alan turned to me and said, remember this moment, because this will never happen again.
Ooh, that sounds neat. What's going on? And Jacob, now he's got that war kind of a feel. And we'd sing along, crazy. We weren't even singing Crazy Horses, but it sounded like crazy something. Crazy horses. It was horses, crazy horses.
Crazy horses.
He says, "Horse, what does a horse sound like?" I got on Donnie's keyboard with a little portamento, and it goes, "Woo, woo." Hey, ka-dunk, and it was just evolved just like that. And we said, "Well, this has got to be something that's meaningful. I just want to write a song about horses. Horses, horsepower, engine, pollution." Because we were really involved in the ecology movement. And we said, "This is it." We do kind of an Indian thing and an Indian-style lyric about horses and drums and pollution and engines churning. Evolved one of our biggest records internationally. Of course, it was banned from Africa. They thought it was a drug song.
Sunshine of my life. Oh, yeah.
Now, are you a very close family, or do you ever fall out with each other?
Oh, we hate each other. No, we're very close.
You bet.
Together.
We're very close.
How important to you is the Mormon faith?
Why are you very important?
Well, it's the reason we feel for all of this, for why this has all happened. We actually got started singing in our church. Where he first sang was in church, and from there it stemmed to other things. It seems that there's a lot of confusion nowadays among especially the youth.
Yeah.
They're asking themselves these questions like, well, why am I here? I mean, where did I come from? What am I doing here? What's going to happen when I die someday? Our Plan album, we just released The Plan, and that was our attempt to answer those questions because we feel that we do have the answers.
Of zodiac revelations, the stations, breaking family relations.
At the peak of our career there, right, we're selling, every album we came out was gold. We really started wanting to say things and be taking our music seriously. And it evolves around our philosophies about why we believe in integrity, why we work so hard, why we have families first, and a lot of it is why we're here on Earth. And we felt that had to come out. And so The Plan came, and we spilled our guts musically.
That's what they said, someday it would be. Now just look around, if that's what we see, it's gotta be the last day.
Mirror, mirror is a chance to reflect on your own life, see if you like yourself. If not, you're the only person who can change that. You have the power to choose the greatest gift you have in life. You can make choices. Darling is about love eternally, not just this life. It goes on and on and on. And then The Last Days is a little bit edgy. We talk about nations taking up their battle stations. You know, less stations, breaking family relations. More families are breaking up right now than you've ever seen in your life. Litigation, allowing shoot-up sensations, there's drugs, there's all of us being legalized and so forth, 23 years ago. We're there, baby, you know, kind of speak, and if that's what you see, it's gotta be The Last Days. It was a little controversial, and we left people, they can like it or hate it, you know, but then Going Home is one that we believe, you know, we're spacemen from other lands, from another, we believe we're ongoing, we're forever, we're eternal, there's great hope, we'll go home.
Some people say, well, I believe in God, but it's more than that to us. I mean, God is real. It's not something that people use to satisfy their hearts, the longing of their hearts. Is there a God? Well, of course there's a God.
We believe something that can really offer people a happy way of living. It's like if you saw a great movie, wouldn't you want to tell your friends about it? Or if you read a great book, you know? And that's how we feel. Of course, you know Mormons are Christians. And a lot of people didn't know that. And so we wanted to make sure that that was known to the world. And we felt an obligation because we believe so strongly in what we believe in.
Is there nine? There's nine in the family. That's right.
Forgot. We didn't get into show business to be something. but to do something. We wanted to share family values to the world.
Number five.
Can I use the pinky?
No.
Can I use my
pinky? No, Come on, that sounds lousy.
Right now, the church is very happy with what they're doing, and they're probably accomplishing as much as if they were on full-time missions.
The thing is, wherever they went, George and Olive managed to kind of create this family. It was like Andrew Belgar. They just were this complete unit that traveled together.
Pleasant as they were, they took no prisoners, Mum and Dad. If Jay the drummer suffered badly from migraine. Now that's not clever anyway, particularly not if you're a drummer. And there were many occasions I can remember, or several occasions I can remember, when really he shouldn't have been performing. But it wasn't the manager who said get on, it was mother or father who said get on.
Alice, Wayne, Meryl, Jay, Donnie,
and Jimmy!
Dear Stink Pot.
Oh, no, Stew Pot.
Dear Stew Pot, can you play Jimmy Osmond's long-haired lover from Liverpool?
Ugh!
I'll be your long-haired lover from Liverpool. I'll
love him anything you say. I couldn't bear it then. Now I'm sure he's a very nice grown-up man, but now I couldn't bear it. I couldn't stand long-haired lover from Liverpool. But I did know the words, very sadly.
I used to look back at all the different things that I had done when I was a child star, and I would kind of cringe, and because here's this little precocious guy that comes out and wiggles around, but now it's funny.
Was 73, was it, where they sold 4 million singles?
5 million.
I 5 million singles.
Yeah.
Again, we
in
made a special
year,
award for that, and I doubt whether that's been achieved by any one artist in a calendar year.
Don't love me for fun, girl. Let me be the one. Love me for a reason. Let the reason be love.
Musical Variety Act of the Year are
Chicago, The Fifth Dimension,
Tony Orlando and Don,
Gladys Knight and the Pips,
The Jackson Five,
and the winner is
The Osmond Brothers,
Donnie and Marie,
Osmond Brothers,
Donnie and Marie.
There was a girl.
There was a boy.
Donnie and Marie started when I was 16 years old, and we showed the world that there's a little bit more than just the right face at the right place at the right time, because there was talent with Donnie and Marie. Even though Donnie and Marie was still looked upon as, Donnie and Marie, it was kind of cutesy, these two little teenagers. And it appealed to the parents, and it appealed to the little kids from about 10 under. Teenagers hated us.
The Donnie and Marie show
was on the cutting edge. It was an early version of like MTV. I think it was one of those things, she sings, she has hits in country music, he sings, he has hits in pop music. Hey, let's put them together. And I think that's where the little bit country, little bit rock and roll thing came from.
I'm a little bit country.
I'm a little bit rock and roll.
I'm a little bit of Memphis and Nashville.
With a little bit of down in my soul.
Don't know if it's good or bad.
I know I love it so.
I'm a little bit country.
And I'm a little bit rock and roll.
What happened? We're family. All for one, one for all. Remember those things that we always learned when we were young? Hang in there together, you know, we're a family. So the brothers said, we'll be your producers then. We'll get behind you and make sure that your music is good, that you've got good looking sets, and that the writing is funny and hopefully inventive, and because we're a family, we're a team. But it did have its impact on our music, and I think it kind of shut us down there for a little while.
Saw mommy kissing Santa Claus underneath the mistletoe last night.
Good evening and welcome to our show. Tonight, our guests are Paul Lynn, the Osmond Brothers, Jimmy Osmond.
We always had this image of the perfect family. I don't want to burst anybody's bubble, but we had our problems too. There was fighting, there was bickering. I am surprised at how well we did get along together because of the amount of time that we spent together. Because the Donnie and Marie show happened in the mid-70s, it kind of smoothed over the split from the brothers. The brothers were still in existence and they were still touring with us, but Donnie and Marie had the demand. And a lot of pressure was on me because I think to a certain extent I was the impetus to break it apart because I wanted to do my own thing.
May tomorrow be a perfect day.
May you find love and laughter along the way.
May God keep you in His tender care
till He brings us together again.
Good night, everybody.
I was basically acting as the president of the Osmond Enterprises. And during that period of time when all our money was basically involved in studios and some investments here and whatever else, and some major, major problems occurred from individuals that had taken our money. And without going into any detail there, we lost millions and millions of dollars, and which sent everybody to take a hard look at what it is we were all doing together. So out of necessity, with the records not selling as well, and with careers all over the place, we all had to split up and do our own things.
It just got too much for me, because up until then I was doing a lot of personal sacrifices and a lot of different things, but there came the time in my life where I said, I have to be Jay. Now, I've been a part of this group and it's been great and I've believed in it, but there has to be time where I can go back, make up for things that I felt were missed, and I guess that's what you'd say. So I went back, and I went back and I went into college. I was an excellent student. I went on two dates a day, you know. Lived a real normal life.
Parallels of Joseph in my life are spooky. I remember sitting down with Stephen Pimlott, my director, and we were analyzing my part. picking it apart, doing the research, figuring out what Joseph was thinking at the time, all of a sudden it dawned on both of us that, wait a minute, this is my life, you know? Because the everything happened about the same ages. My career, after the Donnie Marie show ended and all that kind of stuff, kind of went like that. Joseph was about 17, 18 years old when he was sold into Egypt, right? Everything was just so beautiful, and everything he touched, you know, his father loved, and he was a perfect kid. And for 8 to 10 years, Joseph was in the depths of despair. And for 8 to 10 years, it took me that long to get back on the charts. I accepted the gig when I was about 33 or so of Joseph. Things just took off like crazy.
Keep those I love from me, children of Israel, are never alone. For I know,
and they'll rebuild that right there.
For I know I shall find my own peace of mind.
I had a call the other day, and they said, well, what does the original Olive May sell for now? You guys, this everything of this doll is here, but the original Olive May, and this is really fun stuff to know. I did an online chat on the internet, and we were talking about it, and I did some research. The original Olive May sells up to, I believe it was what, Lisa, what, $800?
The first doll that I sculpted, I wanted to name after my mother because of my tremendous love for her. And she started me collecting dolls. She's the one that created this monster. I love doll collecting. I've done it since I was a kid, and I was 7 when I received my first porcelain doll. So, and every year she still gives me a doll at Christmas. But I really wanted to do it for her. And the doll has just been a huge success.
My mother always called it a beauty mark. I just thought it was a dark zit. But
it's a beauty mark.
Hello there, I'm Mike.
And I'm Donna.
We've come to Branson Country for Ozark Mountain Christmas. If a few of the things you like about the holidays are spectacular lighting displays, beautiful Christmas music, and warm, friendly people, you've come to the right place.
Branson, very unusual place. There's nothing like it in the United States, or anywhere that I know of. There are 30 or 40 theaters here, all operating, all working with live entertainment in it. There are more theaters here than there are on Broadway.
I first heard about Branson from Andy Williams. We were performing together in a stadium show, and he said he was going to be building a theater out here. I fell in love with it. This town is full of people that want to come here to just remember, and the nostalgic acts that perform here is just felt right. I have a real estate and development company, and I started developing and ended up with this theater. And I go, wow, what am I going to do with this place, you know? I called my brothers. I said, hey, you guys, yeah, you want to dust off the cobwebs a little bit and let's perform together. And here's our little theater, and welcome to our theater. Come on inside.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Osmond Family Theater in Branson, Missouri.
It does seem a bit weird that, you know, I'm producing the show and running the theater, you know. It seems strange, but again, I'm real humbled by the fact that they trust me.
We're side by
side by
side by
side by.
Sorrow, but we'll travel the road, sharing our load, side by side.
Make a toast to the entire family. It'd be another great year.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Roses are red, violets are blue. Some poems rhyme and some don't. I think the family is our success. I think that is what I think separates us from other groups.
We missed a you want to call a fish with no eye?
What?
Jason,
all right,
Jason. Jason, you blew it, buddy.
I'd been hospitalized probably 14, 15 times in 1 year. I just got back from Duke University, where I had a team of doctors just basically say that my body is shutting down. I mean, that's what they said to me. But they said, unless you learn some things now, you won't live much longer. You know, it's okay to be a kid. It's okay to goof up a little bit and make a mistake. Nobody's perfect. But when you think you have to be, you know, that's a pretty tough thing. But nobody ever got to me and said, hey, it's going to be okay. So I ended up just flat in the hospital, and it manifested itself by all kinds of problems that I held inside. So I never really enjoyed my life. I kept it so serious.
I lived my life so fast-paced and in such a hyper manner, because of my own nature, not because of show business or my family or anything else, just because of my own nature, that I forgot to enjoy life up until about a year and a half ago, until something hit me over the head like you wouldn't believe it, and that's I got cancer, and I had a brain tumor, if you can imagine. I have never experienced such pain as having my head opened. Good night. I just about didn't make it. And ever since that, I have learned to enjoy every second, not minute, every second that I'm here on this earth, because that was nearly taken away from me.
I noticed my fingers were just not playing my trumpet. I couldn't play my guitar like I wanted. And I did a lot of writing. They weren't responding. It was a very tough time. We thought I had a tumor. And we went to get a check, and very relieved actually to find it was multiple sclerosis. But I took the profile then. I said, I may have multiple sclerosis, but it does not have me. And I'm going to fight. And I think it's my father's drive, my stubbornness to make it work, and a lot of people praying for this guy. It pulled up to the point, I haven't even announced it, but a couple months ago, my hand was no longer drooped. I could only lift my hand like to there. Now I am doing things, and I'm back here. And my legs, next thing, I'm going to get back to normal. I'm playing my guitar again. I'm typing on my internet, my computer. I am back to where I'm playing my piano. And the good Lord's blessed this man.
They had it, others crave it, fame. BBC One's film coming next.